to adopt? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
The report is adopted. Next is a presentation by Kate McHale, the Director of Research for Landmarks Preservation Commission on the Morningside Heights Historic District. Ms. McHale?
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, Chair Lago and Commissioners. My name is Kate Lemus McHale, Director of Research at the Landmarks Preservation Commission. On February 21st, 2017, the Landmarks Commission voted to designate the proposed Morningside Heights Historic District. The district consists of approximately 115 buildings that represent both architecturally and historically the development of Morningside Heights as a cohesive neighborhood of apartment buildings and row houses of the early 20th century. The boundary of the Morningside Heights Historic District extends from West 109th Street to West 119th Street, Riverside Drive to Amsterdam Avenue. It was drawn to encompass the greatest number of intact residential buildings, representing the most significant period of development within Morningside Heights from the 1890s to early 1930s. The boundary excludes intrusions along and adjacent to Broadway, which you can see here, and intrusions we define as more recent buildings, buildings that don't represent the period of development of the historic district, or heavily altered buildings. The buildings of the district reflect the rapid development of Morningside Heights in the late 19th and early 20th century into a cohesive residential district comprised primarily of apartment buildings, along with a small number of row houses and institutional buildings. And briefly, the history of the district. Known as the Acropolis of New York in the early 20th century, Morningside Heights remained largely undeveloped in the 19th century, mostly due to its location on an elevated plateau, the lack of public transportation to the area, and the presence of two large institutions, the Leek and Watts Orphanage Asylum, which is now the site of St. John the Divine Cathedral, and the New York Hospital's Bloomingdale Insane Asylum, which is now, of course, the site of Columbia University. Residential development began in the district with row houses and small multiple dwellings constructed in the late 19th century, shown here. 22 buildings of this period are included in the district. Constructed in the 1890s, these were designed in popular revival styles and represent a late phase of row house development in New York City. They have all retained their historic appearance and contribute to the character of the district. The arrival of the IRT subway in 1904 spurred large-scale development in Morningside Heights, and by 1910, the area was rapidly transforming into a dense urban neighborhood with apartment buildings marketed to the middle class. And as you can see here on the map, 75 buildings were constructed in the first decade of the 20th century. After this initial burst of development, 18 more residential and institutional buildings were built before 1931. During this early 20th century development period, apartment buildings in a variety of styles by some of the city's most prominent architects line the avenues and streets of the district, including Cathedral Parkway, shown here, West 116th Street, Riverside Drive, portions of Broadway, and narrower side streets. Alongside the residential buildings, clubs were also erected to serve the needs of the academic community, such as the former Explorers Club, shown here, and the Alpha Club, a fraternity. Two houses of worship were built during the primary period of development to serve the rapidly growing neighborhood and contribute to the architectural and cultural significance of Morningside Heights. And these are the 1912 Broadway Presbyterian Church and the 1922 Westside Unitarian Church, which is now Congregation Ramoth or In conclusion, the proposed Morningside Heights Historic District reflects a period of remarkable residential development in Manhattan, with its array of well-maintained apartment buildings, houses, clubs, and houses of worship, designed in the popular styles of the early 20th century by some of the city's most prominent architects. Thank you.
We'll turn it over to commissioners for discussion. Commissioner Levin.
I guess we've just received a letter at our places here, so I imagine none of us has had a chance to absorb it, but it's a letter from Columbia University, our former colleague Maxine Griffith, about row houses on 114th Street. I know that we'll all read it carefully when we have a chance, but since this is our only chance to ask you about it, is there anything you'd like us to know about Columbia's argument with respect to those particular buildings? I gather they consider that a potential development site.
Yes.
And how the commission received that argument and what the commission, what the LPC's reasoning was in nonetheless including those buildings?
Yeah. So we did speak with Columbia about those buildings. They were supportive of the overall district, but they wrote to us specifically about those. And their point was that they were less kind of architecturally significant, maybe had some alterations. We analyzed all of the row houses in the district, and that particular group is really from the same time period as all of the other row houses. They all represent this period, earliest period of development in the district. They all have the same level of intactness, and actually this particular group of seven is the largest intact row in the district, and so we felt it merited inclusion.
Commissioner Ortiz.
Could you clarify, there's, you know, one spot on Broadway where you have included that in the district, and the rest is not included. Could you speak to the rationale?
Sure. So the Broadway we had to look at very carefully, because it is a spine that sort of separates two sides of very strictly residential blocks. And there are commercial buildings. There are a lot of buildings that were built sort of after the 1930s, which was the typical end of the period of significance, as we would say. And so there are blocks of Broadway that were not included because they included these buildings we think of as intrusions. Because they didn't relate as well to the history or the architectural quality of the district we were trying to protect. But there were blocks of Broadway that did, and so wherever possible, we tried to include those. So those would include
one block.
This block here.
Oh, I see.
And here, and also here, where we actually could get both sides of Broadway with buildings that merited inclusion.
And just for my understanding, does a historic district, in order to go through this process, need to be contiguous?
We like them to be contiguous. That makes the most sense in terms of capturing sort of the character and also just in terms of how we look at it geographically. And so wherever possible, we do try to include, we try not to have a bunch of non-contiguous little groups of buildings.
And also, just from my own understanding, for buildings that may not, I guess what's the development potential for buildings that may not be historic but find themselves in this district, or does that not happen because you define the boundaries clearly?
We do, historic districts typically do have sites like that, and we tend to call them non-contributing. And so there are four non-contributing sites in this district, which is actually very few. We do include them, and as we have been talking about this kind of idea of contiguous districts, they do sometimes fall within the boundaries. But as non-contributing buildings, there's, you know, kind of more of an opportunity to develop something on that site as long as it's seen as appropriate to the district.
That has to go through.
Yes.
Thank you. Vice Chair Hubble.
I'm just wondering, with regard to these buildings, is their merit more strongly determined by location in this case than it is architectural distinction?
Well, To which buildings?
The 604 to 616 West 114th Street.
Well, the Columbia Street buildings?
Yeah.
It really has more to do with the fact that they are part of a collection of buildings of the same time period that we felt all were similarly meritorious based on their architecture, their level of intactness, and their, their age.
Other questions from the commission? Thank you very much for the presentation.
Thank you.
Item number two on our agenda is also related to Morningside Heights Historic District. Edwin Marshall of the Manhattan office will walk you through the zoning and development patterns within the district.
Good afternoon, Chair Lago. Good afternoon, commissioners. The Landmarks Preservation Commission submitted an application for the designation of the Morningside Heights Historic District. The Historic District comprises portions of Community District 7 and Community District 9 in Manhattan. As stated in a previous presentation, the Morningside Heights Historic District was designated on February 21st, 2017. In their findings, the LPC noted that the area's architecture, built character, and history underscore its importance as an aesthetically distinctive and integral part of the city's urban fabric that warrants designation as a historic district. So the historic district comprises portions of 13 blocks bounded by 119th Street, 109th Street, portions of Broadway and Amsterdam Avenue, and Riverside Drive, as indicated in the red outline. The map to your right is a land use map showing the land use pattern within the area. Again, most of the land uses are predominantly residential, indicated by the yellow. There are some community institutional uses as indicated in the blue. The major institutional uses within the neighborhood are just east of the historic district. This is Columbia University. This is St. Luke's Roosevelt Hospital. And this is the Cathedral of St. John the Divine. This institution also was recently designated as a historic landmark. It was designated on February 21st, 2017. And a briefing package describing that is in your package. These are photographs that typify the existing build condition. The image on the left is 501 Cathedral Parkway, which is at Amsterdam Avenue and Cathedral Parkway, 440 Riverside Drive, which is at 116th Street and Riverside Drive. The zoning is primarily R8. Again, to orient the commission, this is the historic district in here. R8 districts are medium density height factor districts that allow residential building up to 6.02 FAR and community facilities up to 6.5 FAR. Under the quality housing option, a residential building can achieve 7.2 FAR. However, it has to be built within a contextual building envelope. Pursuant to Section 74711 of the Zoning Resolution, landmark buildings or buildings within historic districts are eligible to apply for use and bulk waivers upon application to the Landmarks Preservation Commission. The department is not aware of any conflicts between the subject historic district designation with the zoning resolution, projected public improvements, or any plans for the development, growth, improvement, or renewal in the vicinity of the proposed historic district.
Questions from the commission? Okay, then this will go to public hearing on April 5th, and thank you, Edwin.
Thank you.
Item number three on page 51 of your package is the Manhattan West Phase 3. This is a zoning text amendment to modify the Hudson Yard Special District Public Access Area provisions. Annie White of the Manhattan office will present it for you.
Good afternoon.
Fred Cerullo, Commissioner Cerullo will be recused on this application.
Exiled.
So, good afternoon, Chair Lago, commissioners. This is an application for a text amendment to provisions in the Special Hudson Yards District located in Community District 4 of the Borough of Manhattan. The applicant for this project is Brookfield Office Properties. The site, located at 371 9th Avenue, is within the Central Block Subarea B2, Farley Corridor Subdistrict B of the Special Hudson Yards District. the text amendment to sections 9373, 93731, and 93721 of the zoning resolution proposed to modify provisions of the public access areas of the 9th Avenue rail yard to facilitate the design and construction of the Central Plaza and Dyer Avenue platform. The project site, known as Manhattan West, is outlined here on this map in red and is generally bound by 9th Avenue to the east, Dyer Avenue platform to the west, West 31st Street to the south, and West 33rd Street to the north, and is within subarea B2 of Hudson Yards. Subarea B1, which includes 450 West 33rd Street, is located immediately across Dyer Avenue. This map shows the relationship of sub-district B to the western eastern rail yards of Hudson Yards, the Hudson Boulevard and Park, and West Chelsea. The site was rezoned in 2005 from M16 to C64 as part of the Special Hudson Yards District with the purpose of facilitating the development of a transit-oriented, medium to high-density, mixed-use urban center with a robust open space network. The C64 district and subarea B2 has a total as of right FAR for commercial development of 12 with 2 FAR of community facility uses. This can be increased to a maximum FAR of 19 through the Hudson Yards District Improvement Fund, or DIB. Within subarea B2, residential uses up to 4 FAR are only permitted after 15 FAR of commercial uses have been developed, unless the chair grants a certification to allow residential use to be introduced prior to the completion of the minimum required commercial FAR as provided in section 93.1.22. Here's a land use map of the surrounding area. B1, B2 are outlined in the blue dashed line. The red dotted lines within B2 indicate the public access area boundaries. There'll be a much better image of this in a couple slides. The area surrounding the site contains a mix of commercial, residential, public facility, and transportation utility uses. Along 9th Avenue, tenement buildings with ground floor retail uses are mixed among 12 to 14-story pre-war buildings. Commercial uses are found throughout the surrounding area, including a 16-story building on the corner of 9th Avenue and West 31st Street, and two 18-story buildings on West 33rd Street. Across 10th Avenue from B1 is the Eastern Rail Yard, where the related companies are constructing a 1.7 million square foot office building at 10 Hudson Yards. Additionally, several major institutional and public facility uses are located around the surrounding area, including the U.S. Post Service Mail Facility to the south across West 30th and the James A. Farley Post Office Building to the east across 9th Avenue. You can see those as the large blue parcels surrounding the site here. Here are a couple images that will walk you around the site, which you can see is largely under construction. The image of the top left is looking south down 9th Avenue with this site to the right. These are some more images, mostly looking up to the north. The image on the right is looking north up 9th Avenue. You can see the post office building to the right. As previously mentioned, the Special Hudson Yards District includes regulations for public access areas. In 2014, the applicant applied for a text amendment to modify these public access area requirements for the 9th Avenue rail yard. The map on the left outlines the public access areas defined in the 2014 text amendment, which includes an entry plaza, a central plaza, an art plaza, the Dyer Avenue platform, and the West 31st Street connector. The revised public access area plan of the 2014 text amendment substantially increased the amount of public space, creating a variety of landscaped areas, and allowed for the construction of the platform over Dyer Avenue. This map on the right shows the current proposal of the public access area plan. The blue highlights the minor modifications, primarily extending the central plaza an additional 20 feet to the south. In addition to the delineation of the public access areas, the 2014 text amendment created a phased development plan for the 9th Avenue public access areas. The portion outlined on the right here in red are the public access areas being addressed in this application for phase 3, which includes the central plaza and the Dyer Avenue platform. So this is the architectural drawing, which is the realization of this public access area plan and highlights the areas that have been designed for the site. Here are the four phases of the Manhattan West plan, and which identify the minimum public access areas that must be provided in connection with various buildings on the site. The current application is for phase 3 of Manhattan West, shown here in red, which includes the Northwest Building, the Northwest Retail Podium, the Southwest Retail Podium, along with the western half of the Central Plaza and the Dyer Avenue platform. So to summarize, the actions necessary to facilitate this project is a text amendment to revise and clarify the public access area requirements of Section 9373, 93731, and 93, 721, applicable in the Farley Quarter, Subdistrict B of Hudson Yards. There are more thorough details on the proposed modifications in the briefing packages, but I'll quickly run through some of the proposed changes. To modify entry signage location requirements, under the existing zoning, entry signs must be provided every 40 feet along the entire border of the public access areas. Given the extensive street frontages of these areas, this would result in a total of 12 signs along 9th Avenue alone, creating numerous obstructions within the pedestrian realm on the perimeter of the project site. With the proposed modifications, entry signs will be provided at strategic specific primary access points to the 9th Avenue rail yard, resulting in 5 entry signs. To permit protective bollards within the public access areas, these bollards are required due to the active train yard underneath the platform. As a result of some subsurface conditions, it's not possible to locate all of these bollards outside of the public access areas. To allow a portion of the plaza to locate beneath a cantilever, the southwest tower cantilever is approximately 10 feet over a widened portion of the central plaza, which is not permitted under the current regulations that state the entire central plaza must be open to the sky. The proposed text would allow for this cantilever no greater than 10 feet at this location. To expand the boundary of the central plaza and modify text relating to dimensions and locations of required circulation paths, currently the text requires that the buildings facing the central plaza to be separated by 80 to 100 feet. The proposed design allows for the buildings to be separated from one another by 122 feet on the eastern end and 116 feet on the western end. The applicant believes the wider width will provide a more spacious and inviting open area while maintaining the 12-foot circulation path within 20 feet of the facades. There are also some minor structural modifications, including a relocation of one provision regarding the event space from 9373B4 to 9373B2III. And the most substantial modification is to specify the types of events permitted within the event space. I'll go into a little bit further detail about this. So under the current text, the event space is defined as a 4,500 square foot designated area that can be used for programming throughout the year. When an event is not being held within the event space, tables, chairs, movable food kiosks will be provided. General public events are open and accessible to the general public, free of admission charge. These are things such as concerts, performances, festivals, and they would be able to be held throughout all times of the year. This text amendment would authorize summer events to occur 75 days between April 1st and November 15th for free performances, permitting temporary staging, structures, and seating to extend to 2,000 square feet beyond the event space. You can see the plan for the summer event layout on the bottom right. In the winter, the space may contain an ice skating rink from November 15th to April 1st, which would be open to the general public, but a fee may be charged, provided that the total admission and equipment rental fees does not exceed the highest combined fees charged at a skating rink operating currently in a public park in New York City. The applicant believes these events will draw users and spectators to the Central Plaza to enliven the 9th Avenue rail yard that could otherwise remain unpopulated during the colder season. And a plan for the winter event and potential ice skating rink location is on the upper right. And finally, as permitted under the existing text, the event space would be allowed 12 private events throughout the year in accordance with terms set forth in a restrictive declaration acceptable to the chair. And finally, this text amendment will be accompanied by 2 chair certifications, and I'll just briefly introduce those now. There's one chair certification pursuant to 93732 for public access areas on the 9th Avenue rail yard. This is certifying that a plan has been submitted that provides the overall completion of the Central and Dyer Avenue plazas as required in accordance with the requirements of Section 9373 and 93732. However, only the western and northeastern portions of the Central Plaza will be provided in Phase 3. The fourth and final phase, which will be provided with the development of the Southeast Tower at Manhattan West, will be the remainder of the Central Plaza and the Art Plaza. And finally, a certification pursuant to 93123 for residential use in subdistricts A, B, and E will be joining this application. While the proposed development contains no residential floor area, since this application is now proposing to modify the approved commercial floor area phasing plan to add phases 3 and 4 and to revise the floor area allocations, a new certification under this residential use must be acquired. And I will leave you with a preliminary rendering of the Central Plaza. It is still under some design conversation, so this isn't a final rendering, but it gives you a good idea of what this Central Plaza space will be like. And thank you, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Annie. Questions from the commission? Commissioner Cohen.
Thank you. Thank you for a very succinct report on a lot of possible changes. I had a question about the events. Mm-hmm. So for 12 a year, that could be one a month, or it could be aggregated at the holiday season. Is there any standard worked out among the various privately owned public spaces throughout the city where we would have a sense that this is either similar or in character with those, or is that not related because it's not part of the POPs?
It's not directly related because it isn't a POPs, and I'm not sure what the standards are currently for that. I know the RD, the restrictive declaration to clarify these 12 private events is to come, which will be reviewed by the chair, but I can look into what the relationship between the current POPs restrictions is.
Yeah, it might be useful for us just to know what those are, if there's mm-hmm. a summary of them somewhere.
Other commissioners? Commissioner Levin.
Thank you for this, Annie. It's it's always interesting to look at these things in plan and then to drive down Ninth Avenue and realize, oh, it's really happening. You know, so there's one building up, but it's very unusual for a project to come to us asking to widen public access areas. So I'm curious about the construction or design issues they ran into that are resulting in the two widenings that we're seeing both in the. Mm-hmm. The lower left-hand corner of this image and in the central area.
Right.
What made this happen?
I'm not sure everything that went into the architectural design and construction constraints of the buildings, and perhaps the applicant can better answer that. I do know that there were some contradictory dimensional requirements that made the design of the plaza difficult with the required dimensions of the circulation paths in relationship to the facade of buildings, and when this first text amendment was done, the design has just developed through then. So I know the widening was just to ensure a higher quality space while trying to kind of pack in all of the additional dimensional requirements of the multiple paths and that nature. But I believe that there were probably other considerations, but I can follow up on that.
And then just one more question. I'm curious about the timetable they're on for getting through all four phases of this. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know that's not really part of what we're looking at here, but just kind of a preview of when this might be done.
Yeah, I'll have to follow up about okay. that. I haven't been aware of their exact timeline for phase four, but
Thank
I can
you.
Follow up.
Other questions? Commissioner Cantor.
Thank you. Isn't the plaza portion of it over the two buildings of the tower over the mm-hmm. track?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's.
Okay. So then possibly they're increasing the size of the plaza because they don't want any.
Right. I know there are certainly an extenuated list of subsurface conditions that we had to make adjustments, including the protective bollards and stuff. So that's definitely a possibility. But
are we adding height to the building, to the towers by virtue of this?
I haven't reviewed the changes to the height.
Are, mm-hmm. But they had before in the plaza.
It's a very likely possibility. I'm not sure of that. I'll have to look into that.
Other commissioners? Then we'll refer this item to the community board and the borough president for 45 days.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll ask for Commissioner Cirillo to rejoin us while I call the next item on page 97 of your packets. It's the 50 Nevin Street rezoning. For certification, it's a zoning change and text amendment to create a new mandatory inclusionary housing area to facilitate the enlargement of an existing building to create 128 new affordable housing units. Arned Amin is here to present the application.
Thank you, guys. 50 Nevin Street rezoning. This is an application by the Institute of Community Living to rezone a C61 district to a C64 district within the special downtown Brooklyn district and to designate a new mandatory inclusionary housing area to facilitate the enlargement of an existing building that would result in an approximately 95,000 square foot supportive and affordable housing development with ground floor retail in downtown Brooklyn Community District 2. The project area is located on the east end of a block on Nevin Street, bounded by Skimmerhorn Street to the north and State Street to the south. The surrounding area to the north is part of downtown Brooklyn, the city's third largest central business district, with a range of high-density mixed-use residential buildings, commercial offices, and community facilities. The area to the south is within Borum Hill, a primarily residential neighborhood that consists of 3 to 5 story brownstone row houses, medium density apartments, and a major commercial corridor along Atlantic Avenue. The Fulton Mall retail corridor is 2 blocks to the north, the Brooklyn Cultural District is 2 blocks to the east, and the Borum Hill Historic District starts 2 blocks to the south. The area is extremely well served by transit, with access to the 2, 3, 4, 5 AC, BD, NR, and Q lines, all within 3 blocks, along with numerous bus lines running along Livingston Street, Fulton Street, and Atlantic Avenue. The immediate context adjacent to the project area has been rapidly changing over the past 5 years and includes a mix of residential buildings, hotels, and mixed-use developments. Directly adjacent to the west along Skimmerhorn Street is a new 15-story, 246-room hotel. Directly north across Skimmerhorn Street is a 3-story house of worship and a new 13-story, 202-room hotel. Moving east along Skimmerhorn Street and diagonally across the street, a new 21-story residential building with ground floor retail is under construction. Further east, on the northern side of Skimmerhorn Street, is a new 54-story mixed-use residential development with 750 dwelling units. Across Nevin Street to the east is a 3-story office building with tenants that include the New York City Human Resources Administration and the Jane Barker Brooklyn Child Advocacy Center. South of the site, State Street is primarily residential and contains 3 to 5 story row houses and brownstones. The proposed development site is an L-shaped site at the corner or at the intersection of Nevin Street and Skimmerhorn Street. The development site is split between C61 and R6B zoning districts and is within the special downtown Brooklyn district. The C61 district allows for a mix of uses at different densities, including commercial use with a max FAR of 6, residential use with a max FAR of 3.44, and community facility use with a max FAR of 6.5. The R6B district allows for community facilities and residential uses and has a max FAR of 2 and a max height of 50 feet. The C61 portion of the site is also within the Skimmerhorn Street height limitation area and has a max height limit of 140 feet. The project area is generally coterminous with the proposed development site, Lot 37, but for a 10-foot sliver of applicant-controlled sites, Lots 43, 44, and 45 that are within the rezoning boundary. These applicant-controlled properties are abutting the development site in front on State Street and are improved with overbuilt 4-story row houses that are used as community facilities with sleeping accommodations. The proposed development site is on Lot 37 and is improved with a 7-story, approximately 58,000 square foot supportive housing facility fronting on Nevin Street and a 10-space, approximately 3,800 square foot parking lot on Skimmerhorn Street. The existing building rises to a height of 105 feet and is currently built to an FAR of 4.54. The existing building was built in 1913 for the Young Women's Christian Association, also known as the YWCA. ICL is an experienced non-for-profit provider of supportive housing and took over the operations of the existing building in 1986 as part of a change of provider initiative by the New York State Office of Mental Health. The ICL established the Stepping Stone Treatment Residence, 150-bed residence for single adults with severe mental illness. ICL has contracted with OMH as a residential care center for adults and receives referrals from the state's psychiatric centers, acute care hospitals, and the city's shelter system. Residents currently live in outmoded single-room occupancy units, also known as SROs, that are about 120 square feet and have shared bathrooms on each floor. There is a congregate dining program that's offered and includes three meals a day, and then on-site supportive services for all residents. The applicant is proposing an enlargement and a renovation of an existing building that would create an approximately 95,000 square foot, 100% affordable and supportive housing building with approximately 38,000 square feet of retail. By expanding on a lot that they own, ICL believes that they can implement their mission of providing modern, sustainable, supportive housing and vital services in a neighborhood with extremely high land costs and a scarcity of viable sites. The enlargement would rise 120 feet and would comply with the C64 regulations for the site, which allows for a high density mixed use with a max FAR of 12 and a maximum height limit of 140 feet within the height limitation area and no required parking for the supportive and affordable units. ICL proposes to redevelop the site with a total of 128 units, and this would include a renovation of the existing outmoded SROs into conventional apartments. The proposed development would be 61% supportive housing and 39% affordable housing, with units fully integrated on each floor. The percentage would also bring the project within compliance to the Federal Olmsted Act, which prohibits unnecessary segregation of persons with disabilities. So the enlargement would consist of a 10-story horizontal enlargement of the surface parking lot portion, abutting and integrating with the existing building, and a 3-story vertical enlargement over the northern portion of the existing building. The portion of the existing building within the R6B district would not be enlarged, while the enlargement on Skimmerhorn Street is at a height of 120 feet and is still under the height limit of 140 feet. In conclusion, in order to facilitate the proposed development, the applicant is requesting a rezoning from a C61 to a C64 and to designate a new MIH area to facilitate the enlargement of an existing building that would result in a 95,000 square foot, approximately 95,000 square foot, 100% affordable and supportive housing development with ground floor retail at 15 Evans Street in downtown Brooklyn.
Thank you, Anand.
Thanks.
Questions from the commissioner. Commissioner Delaruna.
Hey, Anand. It's been a while since I've been in this building. I once placed someone there when I was clinical social worker. So I know that it is in need of some renovation. So it would be helpful to know when this comes back, the plan for relocation for the existing residents. This is not a lease based, currently I don't believe this is lease based, it's program based.
Yeah.
But in the new version, it'll be lease based housing.
Yeah. So ICL has started thinking about a phasing plan to relocate the tenants, mm-hmm. and they can probably speak a little bit more to it, but it's going to be a five-phase plan that finds additional community residences for the current tenants who are sort of in a severely mentally ill case, whereas the new building is for people that might be able to live a little bit more independently.
Okay. And I guess the other question I have is really about the property that's in this photo across the street. In your photo, it's number 6. Is that nonprofit owned as well?
So I'm not sure who the owner is, but the tenants include the HRA and a child advocacy center, but I can look up the ownership.
I can imagine that this might trigger interest from that property owner to do the same. So that's my only thought.
Vice Chair Heffel.
Thank you. The MIH classification that's sought here.
Yeah.
That would apply to the 39% affordable units?
So this project is, with the classification of a 60-40 mix, is moving forward with DOB with a bulletin that allows for the whole building to be classified as use group 3. And so it wouldn't technically be subject to MIH, but we're mapping it under this action for any future occurrence if the ICL no longer owns a building in the future.
Commissioner Efron.
Thank you. I was wondering about the three lots also controlled by the applicant and what the plans are for those. I understand there's a height restriction of 140 feet, but presumably there'll be some extra FAR there. What is the plan?
So there's only a small sliver that's being rezoned there, so it's not a huge amount of FAR that's going to be put on that site. And the existing row houses are overbuilt for the R6B zoning district, and it's a separate program. They have about 32 single adults in there, and I don't think, and maybe the applicants can speak to the future plans for that site.
Right, but there's no intention to reallocate some of this to that, or?
No.
Okay. Other questions? Commissioner Levin.
Yes, I have a question about the change in scale that this would involve, and I realize that it's by looking at the relatively new Holiday Inn,
yeah.
This looks like it kind of fits in. But then I ask myself, and I'm asking you,
yeah.
How did the Holiday Inn get to be so big? That doesn't, is that really a C61 building? Or did something else happen there to get it to that scale?
I can look into the history of what the Holiday
what
Inn.
The built FAR is there.
Yeah.
Yeah, because then immediately beyond that is a public school or two that goes through the block. So, you know, I think Commissioner De La Hoz asked the right question about the precedent that this sets for the surrounding area, and I think we have to be careful about that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Other questions? Okay, so this application is certified.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Item number 5 on our agenda, page 123 of your package. Maple Street Open Space and Gardens is an application to site select and acquire property for use as a community garden. Kevin Kraft of the Manhattan office is, Brooklyn office, is here to present the application.
Thank you. Good afternoon. The applicant, the New York City Department of Parks and Recreation, along with co-applicant, the Department of Citywide Administrative Services, seeks a combination site selection and acquisition of the project site for assignment to the Department of Parks and Recreation for continued community garden and passive recreation uses. The project is located at 237 Maple Street, Block 5030, Lot 72, in the Prospect Lefferts Gardens neighborhood of Brooklyn Community District 9. The project site is located in an R6 zoning district with C2-3 commercial overlays mapped along Rogers and Nostrand Avenues. Blocks to the north and west of the project site are designated as the Prospect Lefferts Garden Historic District. The surrounding area is characterized by a mix of single-family, detached, and multifamily residential apartment units with building heights of 2 to 3 stories, commercial uses, and public facilities and institutions. Commercial uses in the area are concentrated along Rogers and Nostrand Avenues. City and non-city facilities located within a half-mile radius of the project site include schools, daycare facilities, food pantries, medical treatment clinics, fire, and police stations. The surrounding area is well served by public transit. The project site is within a quarter mile of the 25 Sterling Street subway station. The B49 bus runs along Rogers Avenue, but stops one block to the north and one block south of the project site. And the B44 bus runs along Nostrand Avenue with a stop one block from the project site. The project site, located at 237 Maple Street, is a 6,000 square foot lot on the northern half of Maple Street between Rogers and Nostrand Avenues. The project site has 60 feet of frontage on Maple Street, which is a narrow street with one lane of auto traffic, one bike lane, and parking on both sides. On the eastern portion of the lot, there are 12 wooden raised planting beds, and on the northeast portion, there are 3 newly constructed compost bins. There is one-story shed on site measuring approximately 200 square feet, which is used by gardeners to store tools. The western portion of the lot is predominantly used for passive recreation. The proposed project site sat vacant between 1997 and 2013 when neighborhood residents worked to transform the lot into a community garden by removing debris and improving the site with gardening beds, composting facilities, and landscaping. The applicant is proposing to maintain the lot's current use as a passive open space and garden. There are no additional structures planned for the site. Upon acquisition, Parks will install new fencing and signage, as well as make repairs to the sidewalk in front of the lot and minor improvements to the site's passive open space, which will be determined through community input at a later date. Parks Department would establish an agreement with the current gardeners under the Green Thumb Program for the operation of a portion of the site as a community garden, while another portion, part of the space, would be designated and maintained as public open space for passive recreation. The project site will be maintained mostly by existing community members invested in the passive open space and garden uses, in cooperation with the Department of Parks and Recreation, Brooklyn Borough maintenance staff. The hours of the park will conform to standard park hours, with public access available from 6 a.m. to 30 minutes after sunset. In conclusion, the actions necessary to facilitate the assignment of the project site to New York City Department of Parks and Recreation for continued community garden and passive recreation uses include a combination site selection and acquisition by the city. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. Questions?
Thank you. How is the acquisition expected to be implemented in this particular case?
There is pending litigation that's surrounding the property. There's private litigation right now with the Kings County Supreme Court. Parks can move forward with condemnation of the site.
Okay.
However, they're going to wait to see how this plays out.
Okay. And just one quick follow-up. You know, in that moment, it escaped me.
We'll come back.
Is there an entity like a block association that's going to be responsible for this?
There are gardeners existing at the space now that Parks will be working with for the Green Thumb Program. It's not a nonprofit. It's just community residents from the neighborhood.
Commissioner, yeah. Back to you.
It came back to me. This won't be, will this be mapped as a park?
It will not be.
It will not be. Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Commissioner Muddy.
Do you know if this was one of the lots that were in the original, there was a lawsuit many years ago about the Green Thumbs because of the fact that community boards were not being clear about them having month-to-month leases and when the city wanted them for development, and there was a whole lawsuit and a list of gardens that were to be saved and those that were to be converted for development. Do you know if this was on the list?
I'm actually not sure if this is part of that list, but that's something I can talk to the applicant about.
Thank you.
Okay. Other questions? Then this application is certified.
Thank you.
Item number six, page 139 of your package, 1150 Bedford Avenue is coming back for public hearing. It's a zoning map change and zoning text amendment to facilitate the development of a nine-story residential building. Kevin Kraft is going to stay here and tell you about it.
Thank you. This is a private application by Bedford Arms LLC for a zoning map amendment to rezone the project area from an R6A zoning district to an R7D zoning district, as well as a zoning text amendment to Appendix F of the zoning resolution to designate a new mandatory inclusionary housing area coterminous with the project area to facilitate the development of 94 affordable dwelling units. The project is located at 1350 Bedford Avenue, Block 1205, Lot 28 in Central Brooklyn on the northern edge of Crown Heights, Brooklyn Community District 8. The development site is located in an existing R6A zoning district, which is part of the Department of City Planning 55 block rezoning of Crown Heights West in 2013. The development site was rezoned from an R6 to R6A district to encourage mid-rise contextual residential buildings. R6A permits a maximum FAR of 3.0, a maximum base height of 40 to 60 feet, and a maximum building height of 70 feet. North of the development site is an M1-1 zoning district, which permits a maximum FAR of 1.0 for commercial and industrial uses and 2.4 for community facility uses. To the south and east of the development site are R6B and R7A zoning districts with C2-4 overlays. These contextual zoning districts produce high lot coverage, 6 or 7-story apartment buildings at or near the street line. R7A districts permit a maximum FAR 4.0 and 4.6 FAR with inclusionary housing and a maximum building height of 80 feet. The surrounding area is characterized generally by 3 to 6-story residential, community facility, and commercial uses. The residential buildings are a mixture of 1 and 2-story family residences, multifamily walk-ups, and elevator buildings. The buildings across Bedford Avenue to the east are within the boundary of the Crown Heights Historic District, and one block south of the development site is Grant Square. There are several community facility uses in the surrounding area. The 23rd Regiment Armory Building, individually landmarked in 1977, containing the city-owned Bedford Atlantic Men's Shelter, is located directly north across Pacific Street. St. Bartholomew Church, landmarked in 1974, is located northwest along Pacific Street. To the west is located an assisted living facility for seniors, Pacific House residents, and Anchor House, a residential substance abuse treatment center. The Fort Greene Grant Square Center, a city-leased senior center and owned by the applicant, is located one block southeast, and adjacent to the project site to the west is Walt L. Shermel Community Garden. The area is also well served by public transit and is located near three subway lines, the Nostrand Avenue Long Island Railroad stop, and two bus lines. Here you can see the existing development site with the Section 8 building on the southern portion of the site. Here you can see the context of the neighborhood looking down Bedford Avenue and Rogers Avenue from Grant Square. The development site, located at 1350 Bedford Avenue, is a trapezoidal-shaped corner lot encompassing the eastern portion of Block 1205, totaling 36,433 square feet with an existing built FAR of 1.88. There are frontages on three streets, including Dean Street, Bedford Avenue, and Pacific Street. The development site consists of an existing six-story, 75-foot Section 8 residential building with 78 income-restricted housing units on the southeast portion of the lot on the corner of Bedford and Dean Street. The remainder of the development site is occupied with a surface accessory parking lot and a vacant approximately 10,000 square foot area on the northern portion of the site. The applicant is proposing to develop the northeastern portion of the lot, currently containing the existing 35 accessory surface parking spaces for the Section 8 residential building and the vacant 10,000 square foot area with a nine-story multifamily residential building consisting of 94 dwelling units, totaling approximately 80,088 square feet. In response to the commission's concerns at certification regarding floor-to-floor heights of the proposed units, the applicant is now proposing the building would reach a height of 89 feet as compared to the originally proposed height of 85 feet. The new nine-story building would be 100% affordable and pursue MIH option 2. 48 of the proposed units would be available for residents earning 80% of AMI or less, and 46 of the proposed units would be available to residents earning no more than 130% AMI. In an effort to facilitate the new affordable housing development, the applicant is proposing to remove the 35 existing off-street parking spaces accessory to the existing building by seeking a BSA special permit to zoning resolution 73-433, reduction of existing parking spaces for income-restricted housing units. The applicant is proposing that the development will provide 23 on-grade accessory off-street parking spaces as required for the 46 proposed government assistant units. The entrance to the parking area will be entered through a 12-foot curb cut along Pacific Street. The developer will offer the new parking spaces to both existing and future tenants with no intention of providing the spaces to the public. Shown here is the proposed development's elevation adjacent to the existing building along Bedford Avenue. The existing building on the southern portion of the proposed development site contains 78 100% affordable housing units, which have been under the federal Section 8 program since 1980 and are expected to remain unchanged in the future with the proposed action. Together, the existing building and proposed building would utilize 148,522 square feet of floor area on the development site and have a combined FAR of 4.08. The actions necessary to facilitate the construction of a nine-story, 100% affordable residential building include a zoning map amendment to rezone the eastern portion of Block 1205, Lot 28 from an R6A district to an R7D district, as well as a zoning text amendment to Appendix F of the zoning resolution, inclusionary housing area, coterminous with the project area. The applicant is proposing MIH option 2. On February 16, 2017, Community Board 8 voted to approve the project with no conditions. 24 in favor, 0 opposed. Borough President Eric Adams held a public meeting on March 2, 2017. There was one speaker in support of this item. Borough President Adams recommended approval with the following conditions: that the City Planning Commission or City Council seeking modification of the MIH section to zoning resolution to permit households with rent burden status to qualify for affordable housing units pursuant to MIH. that the city council seek an appropriate legal mechanism to limit the height of the proposed building, that Bedford Arms LLC provide the city council in writing a letter of intent to retain specific community-based housing development nonprofits to serve as the administering agent, as well as a letter explaining the extent of the developer commitment to pursuing resiliency and sustainability measures, and that HPD modify its affordable housing apartment lottery community preference standards to be inclusive of the school zone attended by a child of a household residing at a city-funded or operated homeless shelter. And finally, that HPD provide commitment in writing that the developer will retain Brooklyn-based contractors and subcontractors, especially designated local business enterprises and minority and women-owned business enterprises. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions from the commissioners? Commissioner Dwight.
So, was there any discussion with the applicant about the height restrictions and the borough concerns to the height R7D? While 89 feet is not the maximum allowed, would there be some kind of restriction placed on the project?
The applicant will be here Wednesday to discuss that, but the applicant has expressed throughout the entire time of this project that they do not want to provide a setback, as it would be cost prohibitive for a 100% affordable housing unit. There's also a land use rationale to R7D. You have a M1-1 district, which allows the sky exposure plane, so there could effectively be a higher building than the proposed building in an R7D. It's also next to a wide street with Bedford Avenue and Rogers Avenue as well.
But how do we restrict it in the event that, you know, once we rezone it, potential for the height to go to 115 feet is there? How do we limit it? How do we legally limit it? So that it's within context of the surrounding neighborhood.
But that's something I can bring up with the applicant and allow them to elaborate a little more on Wednesday.
And my next question is, will HPD be here on Wednesday?
I can confirm with them this afternoon.
So if they can respond to the borough president's comments or concerns, we'd be appreciated. Thank you.
Commissioner De La Rosa.
It would be helpful if the applicant can on Wednesday can speak to how they decided on the MIH options, and if they can bring information about what market rate is in the area. I would think that 130% of AMI is pretty close to market.
Okay.
And that 80% is above what the median income is in the community board. So, you know, I think that may pose some. If part of their argument is that 100% affordable is challenging at 130% of AMI, I think we're pretty close to market.
Okay.
Thank you. Could you just repeat what you said about the applicant applying to the BSA for a variance around the parking? Isn't this a transit area? Why would they have to?
It is a transit area. They're actually, the BSA special permit is for the existing building.
I see. Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Ortiz.
I have a sort of a design question. I mean, clearly the building they're trying to relate harmoniously to, you know, the historic character, but I continue to be confused about why the ground floor windows are so low. I mean, we have a 15-foot floor-to-floor mm-hmm. on the ground floor, and so we seem to have some opportunity to raise the windows up, which would make the ground floor more harmonious with what exists in that neighborhood, which is, you know, windows that are slightly higher up, which affords folks a little more privacy, and seems to result in higher quality unit. So why wouldn't, what's happening on the ground floor that they have a 15-foot floor to floor, but they're putting windows really quite low at eye level?
That's something I'll allow the applicant to speak to on Wednesday.
Kevin, could you repeat what you said to us about the change in the building height? Did you tell us that the building height has changed from certification?
Certification, they were proposing 85 foot height. They are now proposing 89 feet.
Huh. Yeah, I guess I'm not seeing that difference in our briefing material.
That was a very recent acquisition.
Okay, so maybe they can bring us some images of what they're now proposing, because I think we still have the 85.
Yeah, period. That was very last minute.
Okay. Thank you. And I should say I share Commissioner Dweck's concern. We shouldn't be looking at this, because nothing is going to require them to build this. We should be looking at the as-of-right, which is 115 feet. And I'm going to be very curious to hear the land use rationale for that scale on this site, especially considering we have no controls over
you know, whether this actually gets built. Thank you.
Other commissioners? Commissioner Panzer.
Thank you. What are the proposed occupancies of the first and second floor?
Residential.
What's the floor with the arches is also residential?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
The floor with the arches that I'm looking at?
Yeah, that would be residential as well.
That would be residential. And the floor below that?
It's residential.
It's all residential.
It's all residential.
But I can't figure it out either.
Other questions from the commission? Okay, then this item will go to a public hearing on April 5th.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin.
Item number 7 on page 170 of your package is a 110 East 16th Street parking garage. Is an authorization to renew a special permit for a public parking garage for 196 spaces. Jamie Capito from the Manhattan office will present the application.
Hi, good afternoon. 110 East 16th Street. The applicant, Union 16 Parking LLC, seeks an authorization pursuant to Zoning Resolution Section 11-411 to renew a previously approved special permit originally granted in 1916 to permit an attended public parking garage. The project was originally referred on April 25th, 2016 and came back to the Planning Commission on July 11th, 2016. At that time, there were some issues raised by the Commission which have subsequently been addressed by the applicant, and I will be discussing that at the end of the presentation. On August 1960, pursuant to Section 21F of the 1916 Zoning Resolution, the Planning Commission granted a 25-year special permit to allow an eight-level parking garage with a capacity of 154 vehicles. Then in 1961, the Planning Commission approved an application to modify this previously approved permit to allow the enlargement of this garage to include a ninth level and a roof parking for a term of 25 years. Subsequently, the Commission approved the following three applications pursuant to Section 11-411 to extend the period of continuance for one or more terms of not more than 10 years each, which was in August 1986 for an eight-level parking garage for up to 150 cars, November 1997 for up to 196 spaces and eight reservoir spaces, and then in July 2007 to allow the continued use of the attended public parking garage with a maximum of 196 spaces and eight reservoir spaces. Here is a map of the existing zoning and land use. The project site, which is highlighted here in red, is 110 East 16th Street, which is located to the south of 16th Street, which is here, between Union Square East and Irving Place within the C6-2A zoning district, which has a commercial FAR of 6.0 and residential FAR of 6.02. The surrounding land uses are characterized by high-density mixed-use commercial and residential uses in addition to public facility and industrial institutional uses with building heights that range from 2 to 29 stories. To the west of the project area is Union Square Park, and immediately to the west of the project site is a six-story commercial office building located at 108 East 16th Street. Directly to the north of the project site is the city's Human Resource Administration building located here. The Darrell Roth Theater, just to orient you, is located here. And the city and the Lee Strasberg Theater and Film Institute located here, as well as the Washington Irving High School and Gramercy International High School are also located to the east of the project site. The surrounding area is served by the NQRL 4, 5, and 6 subway lines, which are accessible via the 14th Street Union Square Station at Union Square Park. The project site contains a lot area of 6,600 square feet with a total frontage of 65 feet along East 16th Street. The existing 80-foot, 9-story public parking garage on the development site contains a maximum of 196 parking spaces with eight reservoir spaces within the first floor access area. The cars travel between the floors by attendant only, with two vehicle elevators located at the rear of the facility. Vehicles enter the garage with three 10-foot wide access lanes that contain reservoir spaces. These existing curb cuts, however, will be filled in to provide a 35-foot central access to the facility with a 10-foot wide reservoir access lane located just to the right of it. In connection, there will be 12 bicycle spaces provided. The garage operates 24 hours a day. There's not 25 hours. Extra hour in the day.
It's a New York garage.
With a vehicle attendant, and approximately 120 spaces are rented on a monthly basis. There will be no change in use, operation, or capacity as part of this application. Here are existing photos of the parking garage. Here is a view of the area along East 16th Street, looking towards Union Square on the left. The middle picture shows the existing parking garage as is, and here is a picture looking from the south on East 16th Street. In order to allow for the continued operation of the existing garage, an authorization pursuant to Zoning Resolution Section 11-411 to renew a previously approved special permit is required, and the agency which originally authorized such use may, in appropriate cases, extend the period of continued use for one or more terms of not more than 10 years each. In addition, the agency may prescribe appropriate conditions and safeguards to minimize adverse effects of such use on the character of the neighborhood. The project was referred on April 25th, 2016, and came to back to the commission on July 11th, 2016. And the letter to the commission dated June 10th, 2016, Community Board 5 voted in favor of the application. At the July 11th review session, the commission asked about minimizing adverse effects of the garage and asked about screening for the garage as part of this renewal. After further discussions with the applicant, they are proposing to screen each of the floors with an opaque charcoal colored vinyl fiberglass screen, as you can see in this picture to the right. This could help to minimize the effects of the automobile use by screening a large portion of the frontage and help to keep the car headlights from shining onto the surrounding neighborhood buildings. The applicant has also agreed to a 5-year term for the renewal. They are planning to redevelop the parking facility within the next 5 years. That would ensure that the applicant is proposing a cost-effective solution to minimize effects on the neighborhood. And if they're unable to redevelop the building, they would have to come back to the commission for a new renewal and a new review of the meeting of the conditions set forth in the zoning text. That concludes the presentation, and I'm here for any questions.
Thank you, Jenny. Commissioner Reade.
Was it the applicant's request for the 5 years, or was it the department's request for 5 versus 10?
It was the applicant's request, since we had learned that the applicant had a subsequent application in with the Department of City Planning to renew or to redevelop the site. It made sense to go with a 5-year term.
And if they had done a 10-year renewal, would that have precluded the development during that time period?
The 10-year renewal, you know, was a separate, they would have gone forth in addition. They still would have gone forth with the redevelopment of the site.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Levin. Yes, Jamie, thank you for bringing this back. Thank you for getting this wrapped.
I'm glad it's
somehow.
Here.
I have a question about the material that they're proposing to use, because the page that's in our briefing sheet gave me enough information to go look at their website, and I realize it's basically the material is intended for solar screening, like on windows. Are we satisfied that it's durable enough for this harsh New York City environment in an exterior application for, let's say, 10 years, you know, in case it ends up staying up longer than the 5?
I believe we are.
You've thought about what they're proposing here?
Yeah, so that was also part of the discussions we had with the applicant, and we noted that there was the 5-year renewal would be timed approximately when the material would start to deteriorate.
I see. Okay.
So,
okay. But we think it's going to hold up for 5 years.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Thanks. Mm-hmm. Other questions?
I guess this is more technical.
Sure.
When you look at the history of the lot, first of all, I just want to acknowledge the fact that the applicant is responded to the concerns that have been raised and attempting to hopefully successfully create a different impression of the front of the building.
Mm-hmm.
In the history, it goes
and I don't have a problem with this. I just want to understand, is this now a garage that's operating with 9 levels or 8 levels? At some point, it went from 8 levels to 9 levels to 8 levels. So yes. What is actually now? What is the application involved?
Yes, the application currently involves 9 levels.
It's back to 9 levels?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, and one, I'm glad to see that bikes are included in this if they're not already there, but at least formally according to the community board's approval letter, they are certainly acknowledging that in writing, and I think that's great, especially in this neighborhood. Mm-hmm. But I guess the other general question is the time frame from what, was it all about the questions posed by us? Is that what's taken so much time for this to get back to us? Because it just seems like a very long time when you look at the calendar from when this started to getting back to us today.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, so there was a lot of back and forth with just choosing the material, okay. And then we learned recently of the 5-year redevelopment of the site, so we had to take that into consideration in choosing the material and the projected future development of the site too.
Understood. Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you, Manager.
Other questions? Commissioner Kenter.
Follow up on Fred. Are they building another 11?
I'm sorry.
On one of these handouts from you guys, there is the existing garage, there's the proposed garage, and it's obviously one more level. I guess I share his question.
So there is currently there is the ground floor level with the reservoir spaces, and then there is a total of 9 floors that will be where the cars will be parked on.
They all exist now.
Are they adding 1 floor?
No, there will be no proposed changes to the garage. Yeah, there will be no change in use or building form to the garage.
Other questions? If not, then we will schedule this for a vote.
Item number 8, on page 195 of your package, 1164 Broadway. It's also coming back for public hearing. This is a special permit to modify height and setback regulations to facilitate construction of an 8-story addition over an existing 4-story building. Jamie is going to stay and talk a little bit about this also.
1164 Broadway. The applicant, 1170 Broadway Associates, LLC, is seeking approval of a special permit pursuant to Zoning Resolution Section 74711 to modify the height and setback regulations of Zoning Resolution Section 4343 to facilitate the construction of a proposed 8-story addition to the existing 4-story structure at 1164 Broadway. The project was referred on January 17, 2017. At the time, some issues were raised by the commission, which have subsequently been addressed by the applicant, and I will be discussing this at the end of the presentation. Shown here is an existing area map. The project site is located in the Madison North Historic District, which is outlined here in blue. The project site consists of a single zoning lot currently improved with 3 structures developed with the Nomad Hotel and related uses. 1164 Broadway is a 4-story structure that currently contains a ground floor restaurant use and hotel use above that includes accessory amenities and 1 guest suite. 1170 Broadway is a 12-story structure with the existing Nomad Hotel that contains a ground floor retail use with the Nomad Hotel above. 12 West 28th Street is a 4-story structure that contains ground floor retail use with hotel use above. There are no pending recent or pending land use actions that affect the zoning lot. The Landmarks Preservation Commission designated this historic district in June 26, 2001. The historic district is generally bounded by 25th Street to the south, 29th Street to the north, Madison Avenue to the east, and 6th Avenue to the west. 1170 Broadway and 12 West 28th Street, which are part of the project zoning lot, are contributing buildings to the Madison Square North Historic District. 1164 Broadway is a non-contributing building. The project site is located within the M16 Light Industrial Manufacturing Zoning District within Community District 5. zoning districts in the surrounding area include C52 to the east, C64X to the west, and C64 to the north. Surrounding land uses are characterized by a mix of commercial office and retail uses occupied by wholesale office and ground floor retail space, including restaurants and eating and drinking establishments. Buildings in the surrounding area range from 1 to 24 stories in height, with the majority of structures being between 4 and 12 stories in height. Hotels in the surrounding area include Ace Hotel, located at 29th Street and Broadway, and the Nomad Hotel, that each contain restaurants on their ground floors. The project site is served by the 28th Street station at Broadway for the W and R lines. Here is a picture of the existing conditions. The picture on the left shows the existing Nomad Hotel looking southeast towards the project site on West 28th Street. The actual project site is located just to the south of it here. And the middle picture shows 1164 Broadway, this existing four-story structure here. And to the south of 1164 Broadway, we have 1162 Broadway, which is not part of the project site, but it's noted that 1162 Broadway obtained a permit from the BSA, Board Standards and Appeals, which granted a variance in March 2015 in connection with the construction of a new 14-story hotel that waived the setback, height, and side yard requirements pursuant to the LPC-approved design. Here are two images showing the existing structure at 1164 Broadway and the proposed project. The maximum permitted FAR in an M16 zoning district is 10 FAR. There is currently a built FAR of 8.27 of the existing building, and the applicant is proposing a 9.63 FAR. The proposed eight-story addition would allow for the construction of 36 new hotel rooms for a total of 204 rooms to the existing Nomad Hotel. There are no proposed changes to the hotel's existing entrance, currently located at 1170 Broadway. There are no changes also to the lobby or elevators, except that a canopy would be added above the ground floor retail space at 1164 Broadway. Guests of the new hotel rooms of 1164 Broadway would be using the existing entrance, lobby, elevator, and corridor of 1170 Broadway for access. There would be no change to the existing conditions for 1170 Broadway or 12 West 28th Street for the except internal openings on the 5th through 12th floors of the Nomad Hotel at 1170 Broadway would provide internal access to connect the new floors between 1164 Broadway and 1170 Broadway. Shown in this picture is a building section that shows the proposed street wall heights. The street wall height of the proposed enlargement here, which is shown in green, outlined in blue here, shows the proposed enlargement, and outlined in red shows what is being, what's subject to 74711. The street wall height of the proposed enlargement at 1164 Broadway would match the street wall height of 1170 Broadway shown here and other buildings in the surrounding area by having a 12-story street wall located a little over 3 inches from the street line that would rise straight up before setting about 16 feet from the street line at the penthouse level. The proposed enlargement at 1164 Broadway would rise to a total of 160 feet, slightly below the total height of 1170 Broadway, as you can see comparing these two images here. Shown in this image is the zoning waiver plan. Outlined in blue again is the proposed enlargement, and outlined in red is the new encroachment area subject to this special permit. Zoning resolution section 4343 provides that in an M16 district, the maximum height of a front wall is 85 feet or 6 stories, whichever is less, at which a height of 15 feet required initial setback is required from a wide street such as Broadway. The proposed eight-story addition would extend 1164 Broadway street wall to 12 stories or 148 feet, just a little over 148 feet, resulting in encroachment into this 15-foot setback area and penetrate the sky exposure plane above Broadway. Approval of the special permit would modify the height and setback regulations of zoning resolution section 4343 to permit into this proposed addition to permit the proposed addition to encroach within the 15-foot required initial setback. distance and to penetrate the sky exposure plane, which would allow the proposed street wall to align with the existing wall, street wall of 1170 Broadway and other built forms and built within the historic district. The commission at the January 17th, 2017 meeting raised a few issues and further discussing with the applicant, no air rights were obtained from adjacent parcels for 1164 Broadway. Regarding the preservation and maintenance plan, since the property consists of a single zoning lot, the building has contributing portions, which are 1170 Broadway and 12 West 28th Street, and non-contributing portions, which is 1164 Broadway, that required restorative work. And the required restorative work only pertains to these contributed portions of the building. As LPC's practice, the scope of work and the restrictive declaration to be executed upon approval of this special permit incorporates the extensive restorative work that the applicant has already completed under the original 2008 Certificate of Appropriateness in connection with the renovation of the building as the Nomad Hotel. With respect to the non-contributing portion on 1164 Broadway, the Certificate of Appropriateness and the restrictive declaration will require the enlargement of 1170 Broadway to be constructed in accordance with the approved special permit drawings. Finally, under the restrictive declaration, the applicant will be required to preserve and maintain the entire building, both the contributing and non-contributing portions, in sound first-class conditions to undertake maintenance and repairs in accordance with the restrictive deck's continuing maintenance program. The project was referred on January 17, 2017. In a letter to the commission dated February 10, 2017, the Community Board 5 recommended approval of the application with 30 in favor, 0 opposed, and 1 abstaining. In the letter to the commission dated March 30th, 2017, the Manhattan Borough President's Office also recommended approval of the application. That concludes my presentation, and I'm here for any questions.
Commissioner? Vice Chair Knuckles.
Thank you. I think we discussed this during certification, but with regard to the lot line windows that would be covered up by this addition, were those lot line windows permitted by law or not?
So the lot line windows, they would not be legally, it's not a residential building, so they would legally not be required to have, to be visible.
And I apologize, I can't remember if we discussed this at certification, but is there any intention to make any portion of this condominium?
No, this will be 100% hotel use.
Thank you.
Other commissioners? Commissioner Cohn.
Thank you.
Cantor, I'm sorry.
Is there any air transfers involved in this project?
No, so there will be no air transfers from other lots. The only air transfers that I believe took place were only from the floor area used by tax lot 50, which was from, I believe tax lot 50 was 1170 Broadway or 12 West 28th Street. But other than that, there were no other air transfers from previous surrounding lots.
Okay.
Other questions? Then this will go to public hearing on April 5th. Thank you, Jane.
Thank you.
Item number 9 on page 248 of your package, 10 Green Street is a special permit to allow residential use and retail on the upper floors and retail use on the ground floor of an existing building. Sylvia Lee of the Manhattan office is here to make the presentation.
Good afternoon, commissioners. This is a private application by 10 Green LLC, returning as a pre-hearing item after review by Manhattan Community Board 2 and Manhattan Borough President. Manhattan Community Board 2 recommends disapproval of the application. The borough president recommends approval. I'll get into the details of their recommendations after a brief overview of the application. You may recall that the applicant requests the grant of a special permit pursuant to Section 74711 of the zoning resolution to allow use group 6 retail use below the level of the second story and use group 2 residential use on the upper floors of an existing 5-story building plus penthouse located at 10 Green Street within the M15B zoning district in the Soho Cast Iron Historic District, Manhattan Community District 2. As shown on the area map, the project site is located on the east side of Green Street. between Grand Canal Street and Grand Street on the southern edge of the Soho neighborhood, north of Tribeca. North of Canal Street, the surrounding area is mostly zoned M15B district, where light industrial and commercial uses are permitted as a right up to 5 FAR. Use group 2 residential use is not permitted as a right, and use group 6 retail use is not permitted below the level of second story in any building. The surrounding Soho neighborhood, buildings range from 3 to 13 stories in height, consisting of low-rise row houses, mostly along Canal Street, and mid-rise loft buildings north of Canal. The predominant uses in the surrounding area are retail establishments, commercial galleries, furniture showrooms, wholesalers at street level, and commercial offices, joint living workforce of artists, and a variety of dwellings on the upper floors. To the south of the site in Tribeca, the buildings range from 2 to 7 stories in height and are predominantly mixed use as well. As shown here on the photo collage of the east side of Green Street between Grand and Canal Street, buildings are similar in height. Mid-block buildings have very consistent cast iron facades with stylistic variations. Penn Green Street is shown here in view 3. A new building, mixed-use building, is being constructed across the street, shown here. As shown on the site plan, the subject zoning lot has about 28 feet of frontage on Green Street and measures approximately 2,800 square feet in lot area. The site is improved with a 5-story building that rises to about 82 feet in height and has an FAR of 4.35. The building was built in 1869 for textile manufacturing and warehousing and used for manufacturing through around 1995. To the best of the applicant's knowledge, subsequent to 1995, the building had been used by a variety of commercial uses. Most recently, the ground floor of the building was used for retail and office. The upper floors housed a variety of commercial tenants, including offices, commercial galleries, showroom and storage uses. The applicant acquired the building at the end of 2014, at which time only the ground floor and fourth floor were occupied. The building became fully vacant at the end of 2015. The applicant proposes to convert the building to residential use with ground floor retail. A penthouse addition would also be constructed, shown here, which would set back 20 feet from the street line and rise to a height of approximately 102 feet within the permitted bulk envelope. And so there's no requested bulk waivers here. Specifically, the applicant proposes to use 1,991 square feet on the ground floor and a portion of the cellar for use group 6 retail use, shown here in dark gray, and use about 11,680 square feet of floor area on the upper floors, penthouse, and portions of the ground floor and cellar for use group 2 residential use, shown here in light gray. In total, the proposed project would have an FAR of 4.86 and a total of 4 residential units. The proposed development also includes a comprehensive restoration of the facade, storefront, stoop, and window elements as identified in the LPC-approved restoration work plan. A long-term maintenance program has also been established to ensure the preservation of the building in perpetuity. Section 74711 allows the commission to modify use regulations in the M15B district, provided that certain conditions regarding historic preservation are met and the outlined findings can be made. The application was certified and referred out to the public on December 12, 2016. At its full board meeting on February 16, 2017, Manhattan Community Board 2 recommended denial of the application by a vote of 23 in favor, 12 in opposition, and 1 abstention. In their resolution, CB2 states that the loss of new opportunities for joint living workforce artist units is a threat to the special character of the neighborhood, and that the commission should prescribe conditions and limit the use change to only include ground floor retail. On March 17, 2017, the Manhattan Borough President issued recommendation to approve the application with the understanding that the special permit does not involve the loss of existing joint living works for artists or other protected units, and that the applicant agreed to work with nonprofit or art organizations, Department of Culture Affairs, and EDC's Made in New York program to explore artisanal, cultural, and creative tenants for ground floor and cellar space. That concludes my presentation. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Questions from the commission? Okay, spell the other side, and we'll go to the public hearing on April 5th.
Thank you.
Item number 10 on page 290 of your package, the boulevard at Highland Plaza are authorizations to allow a group parking facility and a reduction of the parking requirement to facilitate the redevelopment and enlargement of an existing shopping plaza. This is becoming for public hearing on the draft environmental impact statement on Wednesday, and Joseph Helferty is making the presentation.
Thank you. Good afternoon, commissioners. As some of you may remember, this project was before a review session on January 30th, prior to its referral to Community Board 2. I'm here to discuss with you today, in a brief recap, the proposed development at the Boulevard at Highland Plaza, where the applicant is requesting CPC authorizations for the layout of a group parking facility and a reduction in parking requirements in a C41 zoning district, as well as chairperson certification for cross-access connections to facilitate the redevelopment of the Highland Plaza Shopping Center located in the Newdorf neighborhood, Staten Island Community District 2. The site is bound by Highland Boulevard to the west, Eppett Street to the south, Mill Road to the east. The existing shopping center is tenanted by a mix of small and large retailers, including a movie theater, big box department stores, a pharmacy, and several smaller clothing and dining establishments. The area is served by 5 local and 4 express MTA bus routes, and the Newdorp station of the Staten Island Rapid Transit Rail Line is approximately 8 blocks to the northwest. The site is located in a C41 zoning district, reflecting the large-scale destination retail uses that predominate Highland Boulevard to the north and south of the site. The block north of the site contains a mix of retail uses fronting Highland Boulevard. So there's a recent commercial development here, as well as the U.S. Post Office and other large-scale destination retail uses here, as well as a mix of attached homes also here on the block north. The block south of the site is also characterized by a mix of commercial retail fronting Highland Boulevard and residential uses along the Mill Road frontage, which includes a series of low-rise elevator apartment buildings fronting Ebbett Street and Mill Road. The areas to the east and west of the site are largely characterized by single-family detached and semi-detached homes. The project area consists wholly of Highland Plaza, a 357,000-square-foot shopping center located in an approximately 24-acre lot, shown above in its existing conditions in its 2010-approved site plan. Highland Plaza was originally constructed in 1958 with 348,000 square foot of floor area and 1,448 accessory parking spaces. This is prior to the 1961 zoning resolution. In 2001 and again in 2010, the CPC approved applications for authorizations for the reduction in parking to facilitate smaller retail additions. As of the 2010 approval, the site is currently at a reduction of approximately 30% of the required parking. There are currently 5 retail buildings with approximately 357,000 square feet of existing floor area and 1,414 parking spaces on the site. Accessory parking for the commercial uses is primarily located between Highland Boulevard to the west and the large retail building here to the east is the primary parking area. The access to the parking is provided primarily through the curb cut here at the intersection of Highland and Beach Avenue with additional access slightly south of that on Highland Boulevard and a curb cut located here on Ebbett Street. Access for truck loading along the Mill Road frontage over here, which currently serves as the back of house operations for the site, where they have loading berths located here for the larger retail uses. There are also approximately 350 parking spaces located along the Mill Road frontage, slightly to the northeast. However, they are rarely occupied due to the lack of entrances and pedestrian connections through the site. The redevelopment will consist of the demolition of approximately 290,000 square foot of retail buildings, shown above in green, the continued use of 3 existing buildings, shown above in blue. The demolished buildings will be replaced with 3 new retail buildings, totaling 386,000 square feet, fronting on a new through lane that begins at the existing curb cut at the intersection of Highland Boulevard and Beach Avenue, located here. And continues to the center of the site at an oval-shaped roundabout located here. The through lane then continues further east to a new curb cut on Mill Road, creating a new vehicular circulation lane that travels east-west through the site. The applicant refers to the portion located between the 2 proposed 2-story commercial buildings as Main Street, which will be discussed in greater detail later. So that's this portion here is Main Street. The proposed redevelopment includes a total of 11 curb cuts, including 3 on Highland Boulevard, 4 on Mill Road, and 4 on Ebbett Street. The applicant states that the addition and modification of these proposed curb cuts is intended to provide better access to the relocated parking fields and allows for better truck access to loading areas. At the ground floor, there'll be a series of smaller retail uses fronting onto Main Street, which would be fronting onto this new through lane here, as well as a large grocery store, which fronts towards Highland Boulevard, and a one-story retail pad at the intersection of Highland and Beach Avenue located here. Parking areas will be located between Highland Boulevard and the grocery store, behind the new buildings that front onto Main Street, as well as diagonal parking along the center of Main Street shown here. Parking areas behind the buildings and a ramp to a second-story parking deck will be accessible from curb cuts on Mill Road and Ebbets Street, as well as the roundabout located at the center of Main Street. The two new buildings will be, two new two-story retail buildings will be supported by four separate loading areas located in the rear of the buildings. One here to the northeast, and three supporting the southern building, one here primarily for here for commercial uses, as well as two loading berths here to support the larger commercial uses and the supermarket that's going into this portion of the building. In addition, the applicant is proposing future cross-access connections, one which will be opened upon development of this shopping center here to a recent commercial development as of, I believe, 2014, and one future cross-access connection, which would be, the easement would be mapped here to where the existing post office is in the event of a redevelopment of that site. The second story of both buildings will include commercial space for larger retailers, as well as a movie theater in the northern building, and a second-story parking deck in the rear of the southern building. The two buildings are connected by a transparent sky bridge that connects the open pedestrian galleries at the front to the second level retail of both buildings, highlighted here in red or these. The sky bridge is approximately 160 feet long, 15 feet wide, and includes a seating area at the midway point. At the ground level, Main Street is intended to be the primary activated frontage of the development. Main Street is approximately 100 feet wide, curb to curb, and contains 100 diagonal parking spaces. The proposal includes 32-foot-wide, partially covered sidewalks on both sides of the street, which provide pedestrian access to the ground-level retailers and second-story commercial uses. In addition, the sidewalks along Main Street provide areas for bicycle parking, opportunities for outdoor dining, areas for planting and seating. At the center of Main Street is a roundabout, which provides vehicular access to the parking areas in the rear of both buildings. Raised crosswalks will be provided as a traffic safety measure for pedestrians crossing Main Street. The applicant has provided the following illustrative renderings to give a better idea of the look and feel of Main Street. This view here is from the center traffic oval, at the center of the development facing towards Main Street. And this additional view here is from Main Street facing west, where you can see the partially covered sidewalks, planting seating areas, and the sky bridge out here in the distance connecting the second level of these buildings. In total, a net increase of 102,000 square feet of floor area and 239 additional parking spaces is proposed on the site, which upon completion will result in approximately 359,000 square foot shopping plaza with 1,653 parking spaces. In addition to seeking authorization for the layout of the parking area, the applicant is also requesting a reduction in required parking. The site currently contains approximately 356,000 square feet of floor area and provides 1,414 parking spaces, a reduction of up to 37% granted by the 2010 CPC authorization. The applicant's proposal increases the floor area of the development by 102,000 square feet. All uses on the site, from both the new buildings and the buildings that will remain, would require nearly 3,300 parking spaces. The applicant is seeking to provide 1,652 spaces, which is a reduction of 49.8% of all required parking for commercial uses on the site. The redevelopment would result in a net increase of 239 spaces from its existing conditions today. As per Section 36-023 of the Zoning Resolution, the City Planning Commission may permit a reduction of up to 50%. The applicant states that the reduction is justified by the results of their comprehensive parking analysis, which show that both the existing and proposed development during peak weekday and weekend hours are operating at a below 40% utilization rate. To facilitate the proposed development, the applicant requests the following actions. Layout of group parking facility, where the commission may authorize the layout of commercial parking lot on lots greater than 4 acres. To meet the commission standards, the applicant states that the action allows for the creation of Main Street, connecting the existing entrance to a new curb cut on Mill Road, improving pedestrian and vehicular circulation throughout the site. The parking area is located behind Main Street, along Main Street, behind retail buildings, and in the second level parking deck, allow for less travel distance from parking areas to retail buildings, and that the four new curb cuts proposed along Mill Road and Ebbett Street provide equal vehicular and pedestrian access from the neighborhoods to the east and limit interaction of loading areas with public areas. Regarding the reduction of parking, commission may authorize a reduction of up to 50%, provided the proposed parking is deemed sufficient. The applicant is requesting a parking reduction of 49.8%, as I previously stated, from 3,293 required spaces to 1,653 spaces. The proposed development has triggered the need for a targeted environmental impact statement to analyze traffic, air quality, noise, hazardous materials, land use zoning and public policy, and neighborhood character. The draft EIS has concluded that the project would result in potentially significant adverse impacts with respect to traffic. So as stated here, there were 10 intersections in the vicinity of the boulevard that were analyzed. And of these, up to 7 of them were deemed to have some potentially adverse impacts. The DIS has identified unmitigated impacts at the intersections of Highland Boulevard and Beach Avenue, Highland Boulevard and Newdorp Lane, and Highland Boulevard and Ebbett Street. Currently, the feasibility of additional mitigation measures is being explored with New York City DOT and would be disclosed in the FEIS. Also, as previously stated, public hearing for the draft EIS is being held this Wednesday, April 5th. Staten Island Community Board 2, on March 21st, voted in favor of this application with no objections or conditions. 23 members voted in favor, 0 opposed, 0 abstentions, and 1 not entitled vote was cast. In summary, the proposed actions will facilitate the redevelopment of the aging commercial center into a pedestrian-oriented retail destination through the reconfiguration of parking lot layout, which allows for less distance from parking areas to retail buildings. A net increase of 102,297 square feet of commercial floor area and 239 parking spaces are being proposed, which is a reduction of 49.8% of required parking from 3,293 to 1,653 parking spaces. Thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Joseph. Questions from the commission? Commissioner Besser.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions, some of which I'll probably pose Wednesday versus going to all of them today, but I just wanted to know if the Department of Transportation would commit to implement, you know, additional signal timing and phasing changes at the intersections at question, in question. And I know you kind of touched on that they will respond, but that's quite important. There are two public schools not far from this location, and they walk, you know, the students walk to the bus stops, you know, daily, back and forth to school, and you know, there's of course pedestrians at the bus stops and walking around the location. So I just think it's very, very important to ensure, you know, that that's looked at. Also, I wanted to know more about the truck access points and if the trucks will be going down Main Street, or if they'll just be able to access the you know, where they're loading and unloading, because that's important as well. And the parking analysis, the utilization rate. Was that done, and I think I asked this at certification, was that done at when Pathmark was closed? Was it done when Pathmark was open? That's an important question. I have quite a few others, but I guess I'll just post them on Wednesday. Thanks.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Cirillo.
Joe, thank you. I guess a couple myself. Just when the DEIS identified the unmitigated impacts at the three locations, which are obvious, I guess there's two questions I have. One is, how are they the result of the new development, or how do they play into the fact that this is an existing shopping center? With, it's Highland Boulevard, it's a shopping center, there are unmitigated impacts today. So are they new in addition to the impacts today? Is it, sort of is a collective new impact, or is this just sort of a restatement and reorganization of unmitigated impacts along Highland Boulevard at the exact three locations that we can all imagine they would exist at? Do we know, is that clear?
I believe that that is clear, and it might be something that's better addressed during the environmental impact.
Okay, so I'll save that question. The other thing is this, when they did the DIS, I mean, the one interesting thing about this development compared to the, we'll call it the existing shopping center, even though it's already going through, you know, Path Market's closed, there's lots of things happening there. And being familiar with this, the original shopping center, it was Highland Boulevard driven. Everything went to Highland Boulevard. And Mill Road, I mean, back in the 50s and 60s and even the 70s was, you know, that was sort of a sneak around avenue unless you went to the bowling alley, which is now gone. This design incorporates Mill Road as a main piece of this shopping center. I mean, the sort of Main Street concept connects now what is, I mean, Highland Boulevard, it's much more Main Road as than Mill Road, but Mill Road is a, you know, major thoroughfare, we'll call it. I'm sure the residents there don't want to call it that, but it is. In these impacts, are we taking into account that Mill Road will now be another option for people to feel incorporated into this shopping center? Because in the past, the back of this, where Mill Road was nothing more than a truck loading area, and it had parking, although no one in the world would park there because you were so disconnected from the shopping center. You were like in the back of the shopping center. And there actually was only one option to get to the front of it, and that was through a bank teller drive-through. So there was no actual real access point. So nobody parked back there, and it was kind of almost spooky in a way, even though it wasn't not well lit. But now we're turning this development into a way that incorporates both main roads on both sides. So I wonder what impact, if at all, if that was a consideration in this, or they were just looking at people still using Highland Boulevard the way culturally they would use Highland Boulevard, which was the way in and the way out. Because this actually provides another option to get in and around the shopping center to New Dorp Lane, to Tyson and Guyon Avenue. So I just, do we have any idea of how this has been? Or it's another question I could pose.
It was, I believe you can probably get a more detailed answer.
Sure, understood.
But it was a stated goal of the applicant to increase pedestrian and vehicular connections to the neighborhoods to the east.
Yeah.
Additionally, with the environmental impact statement, you know, while numerous intersections were viewed in the vicinity of the project, you know, the three that you've already mentioned were kind of known for their, for having an impact just from the existing context of the neighborhood, were on Highland Boulevard, so it wasn't, the development wasn't adversely impacting Mill Road intersections.
Yes.
But it is a stated goal of the applicant to, you know, help open this project up to the neighborhood to the east.
Well, certainly the design does that, and I think at some point the practical use of the way this is designed will also relieve some of what looks like, and certainly may in fact be, traffic congestion at the corners that have been identified. I don't question that that wouldn't be true. I question whether or not it's new or not. But I understand. I just have one, Madam Chair, just one further question. And this is just a clarification point. The parking reduction percentage is always based on the original maximum requirement. Right, we're not working off of the previous numbers where we're coming down, and it's always back to square one in terms of reducing the parking.
Yes, this is not a further reduction of the 2010 authorization.
Right.
This is a reduction of the total commercial uses for both proposed
based
and existing buildings, which were approximately 3,300 spaces required for that.
Correct. So on a practical level, we are still talking about the fact that there are about 250 additional parking spots in this development than there exists today.
Yes, it's 239 parking spaces. And additionally, with the reorientation of the buildings, some of those parking spaces that were previously segmented off to the Mill Road frontage are now accessible from multiple points of access.
Well, you know, I just say this is more of a general policy question, and I'm never one to actually recommend reducing parking. So this is, and I'm not suggesting doing that here, but there is something to be said about the fact that the numbers project so much, you know, in a situation like this, no one's going to say, I don't need parking when they know that's going to be a convenience. And in a community, especially where the car we know is part of the day-to-day operation, even though this is on a pretty main road with other means of public transportation, people, you know, it's not that that's the way they're going to get to the shopping center or the movie theater. But I guess at some point, it would be interesting to see if some of these numbers and percentages that are so old in the system actually make sense. Or, I mean, obviously, if you can come for a waiver or a reduction, you have the opportunity to do that. But there might be a process which makes, obviously, applicants' jobs easier, less costly. It makes our work, you know, more efficient. And just a thought process about that. Anyway. That'll be the only thing I ever say about parking reduction.
So having had the pleasure of working on Staten Island for about 3 years now, I used to frequent this mall when Pathmark was around, and you're absolutely right. It kind of, the configuration of the design of the mall blocks you from what's on the other side. And when you realize there's Mill Road behind there, most of us that know will go beyond and use Mill Road and Ebbets Field. Those two streets are, to the magnitude of traffic on Highland, these two streets are like ghost streets. You see maybe one car, and every 10 minutes, it's really really less traffic. And you only have, I see that the developer is only planning one entrance, which is the main boulevard entrance, which exists today, so the configuration is not changing there. Opening up, then you can see now that there's a neighborhood beyond, which is good. Is there any way of sort of, and of course, taking into consideration the traffic issues that Commissioner Besser and Commissioner Cirillo mentioned, I mean, would it behoove the developer to try and get traffic out to Mill and Ebbets? Because when it's really congested in Highland, you have Chipotle, the post office, New Dorp, the high school, ShopRite, and all that just gets completely congested. If you loop around the back and you come out front, you actually come out quicker than you would if you try to come out straight. Is there any way of maybe encouraging the developer to try and get Highland as an entrance and maybe the other exit that's an exit? I mean, I think that would alleviate some of the traffic concerns that are there.
So to your first point about the exit that's onto Mill Road, so there is the primary exit at Main Street here. However, there are two additional curb cuts north of that, so one located here underneath, kind of below the second story of the building, and one up here in the northeast corner. So, you know, this is primarily servicing parking in the rear of the northern building, and this is, you know, servicing the, you know, visitors as well, but also for truck loading. And then there are also two additional curb cuts in a similar orientation to the south of that. But I would agree that, you know, as there becomes opportunity to open up traffic leaving out onto Mill Road, that this is something that...
Also, you know, it's going to flow naturally, yes, because if you're going to go to that side of the mall, you're not going to want to come on Highland Boulevard, which is going to drive you crazy. You're going to go down Ebbets and then come up Mill, or you're going to get on New Port Dorp and then come down Mill. So I guess after, as the development matures and gets built, I will see if the traffic patterns will work.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? Commissioner, please.
Hi. Thank you, Commissioner Cirillo, for mentioning parking reduction. I believe I said something very similar at certification, because it's true. I mean, we're, you know, this is the equivalent of 6.6 required spaces per 1,000. Square feet, which, you know, if you know anything about that, that's just tremendously high. No one does that anymore. And so I have a question actually along those lines. You know, I know perhaps it's just for me, for my own personal interest, that at times owners like Kinko have restrictions or parking requirements built into their leases. You know, did they end up having to go back to tenants to renegotiate pieces of their lease in order to be able to advance a lower parking requirement? I'm curious if the applicant could answer that. And then on the shared parking analysis, Commissioner Besser mentioned a question that I think is important. You know, when the analysis was done with respect to what other uses are there? Because I know the supermarket requirements here are 10 spaces to 1,000 square feet. So I'm sort of curious how that works. And are we able to see a summary, you know, the executive summary of the parking analysis?
Commissioner Delahose.
I just want to confirm that the traffic consultant will likely be here on Wednesday to answer all these questions.
Seems like a good idea.
You will.
Just check.
Yeah. They will now.
Other questions from the commissioner? Commissioner Besser.
Just a quick one. There are residential units on Mill Road that are adjacent to the proposed development site.
Yep.
And I believe I read that there would be a fence with perimeter planting. I just wanted to know, is that going to be a sound barrier fence, and if it could be?
I don't believe that the fence has been inspected to any particular standards aside from our standard requirements for screening between district boundaries or different uses. But it also does follow the planting requirements located along perimeter of the site as well. But I believe that the orientation of this development, or one cannot exactly see it here, but the perimeter of that development is the parking loop road. So there aren't residential uses. The residential units are not directly up against that fence. It's the their private road and parking there as well. So there is a bit of a buffer on that development.
Commissioner Cantor. Thank you. The mitigation issue comes about because these cars are going into this new facility, right? The main road, if you will, is being blocked or impaired because there are more cars going into this new facility, expanded facility. Is that accurate so far?
Well, there is an increase in floor area with the proposed development, so you know, as per these requirements, it would happen.
Now, there's a presumption, based upon what was legal, there's a presumption that they got more space than they need, right?
The presumption from the parking analysis is that there would be, at the proposed development, still only 40% utilization rate.
If indeed it's incorrect, and you're getting cars backing up the five parking spaces, will that not further impede traffic on the street?
I believe that this was the intent here, was that opening up additional curb cuts on two new frontages that previously were not considered the main frontage of this development was, you know, an effort to mitigate that effect. But additionally, the main signalized entrance here does not let right out into the parking areas. It has this kind of drive aisle that continues out to the, It has this drive aisle that continues out to the center of the site to try and prevent this from happening, people turning in and out of parking spaces at the main entrance.
So they're acknowledging that space hunting can back up the street.
That exists today.
Yeah.
I believe more than that, the applicant is probably more qualified to speak to that.
And the applicant and his traffic consultant? Well, you were in.
For the hearing, yes.
Okay, never mind. Thank you.
Commissioner Becker.
Thank you. How many tenants are planning to return?
We do not have that information at this moment, but you have to ask the applicant.
And is the developer planning on renovating the section that remains in this development that's untouched?
Yes, it's not a substantial improvement to the footprint of the building, but it would be improvements.
And approximately how many jobs will be created as a result of this development?
I do not have that answer at this time. It can be addressed on Wednesday.
Other questions? Well, I guess we are in for quite a lengthy questioning session when the public hearing on the DEIS occurs on April 5th.
Item number 11, page 323 on your package. Watson Avenue rezoning is a zoning map amendment and zoning text change to establish a mandatory inclusionary housing area to facilitate the construction of four buildings with 286 residential units and retail and community facility space. Manny Lagares of the Bronx office will tell us about what happened to the community board and borough president.
Okay. This is coming back for pre-hearing review. It's the Watson Avenue rezoning, and the applicant is the Asmuth Development Group. They're requesting a zoning map change from R5 to R7A with a C14 commercial overlay. Also, an R5C12 to an R7-C14 overlay. The project is located in the Southview section of Bronx Community District Number 9. You can see right in the center here is the project site for the rezoning. The block is bounded by Gleason Avenue on the north, Commonwealth to the east, Watson Avenue on the south, and you have Rosedale Avenue forms the western boundary. The site contains, and you can see by the outline here, a one-story approximately 12,200 square foot house of worship with accessory parking. And immediately across the street, you have the New York City Housing Authority, Justice Sotomayor houses, which are 28 multiple dwellings with approximately 1,500 units. These are seven stories in height. Across the street on Rosedale Avenue, you have this huge block here, is the Gleason-Watson Park, and you have active and passive recreation, as well as some tot lots. And just north of the project area, you have a row of three-family attached homes here and also here. And across on Commonwealth Avenue, you have more residential. This four-story building is veterans housing. And then you have another row of three-family, and then you have some two-family mixed in on this side here. The map here shows you the before and after. You have the current zoning here, which is R5, and you have the overlay, which goes in 300 feet. Your R5 has a 1.25 residential floor area and the 2.0 community facility FAR. And the C12 has a 1.0 FAR. On the proposal, you have the establishment of the R7A zoning district, and with the MIH, which is also part of this application, you're going to get a 4.6 FAR. And that was the third action, the zoning text amendment to Appendix F of the zoning resolution to designate the rezoning area as an MIH area. This is the site plan for the development, which will consist of four attached buildings. The first one is Building A, which is a proposed nine-story building with approximately 107,000 square feet of residential floor area, nine stories. And Building B, which fronts on Watson Avenue, was a proposed eight-story building with approximately 113 dwelling units and approximately 101,000 square feet of residential floor area, inclusive of a ground floor retail area, which is approximately 17,000 square feet. A ground floor commercial. The building here in the tan, Building C, is a proposed nine-story building, contains approximately 50,000 square feet of residential floor area, and is proposed for 53 dwelling units. And right adjacent to that is your proposed community facility use, which will go to the House of Worship. It's a three-story building with approximately 10,000 square feet of floor area. Even though this project is located within the transit zone, they are going to provide 56 accessory parking spaces at the center here. And the way that you access, you could either go Rosedale or Commonwealth. You have a 30-foot curb cut here, two-way. You come in here, go beneath this building here, and you park inside here. They're also providing approximately 150 bicycle parking spaces within that area. You can see this drawing here will show you, it removes the section of the building that I just showed you.
When you access your parking, just come in here and go right in here. And here is your massing. With the R7A, you have a maximum base height of 75 feet and a maximum height of 95 feet. The tallest building, which is your nine-story building, will be 85 feet. And these are renderings of what the buildings will look like. And you can better see this, again, the access to the parking. You can see it clearly here. Just go right in here. And beneath the building, the trees that are mandated by the Quality Housing Program. And this is another, this is your Watson Avenue perspective. And the Community Board recommendation, Community Board number 9, unanimously approved the application by a vote of 25-0-0. They did have conditions, and the conditions were to incorporate a senior housing component with veterans' preference, also to allocate space for volunteer ambulance rescue squad, also to provide 24-hour security. They want security guards. And also to create jobs, high-quality jobs. These will be service jobs. And also to collaborate with the United Hispanic Construction Workers to ensure that at least 25% of the construction jobs go to persons residing within Community District Number 9. The borough president approved without any conditions. However, he's concerned about the small size of the units. He would like to see larger units. His other concern was that the applicant stated that he's going to provide 20% of the affordable units at 80 to families earning 80% or less of AMI. Now, there could have been a mistake that in the testimony or an error, but the applicant is asking for option 2, which is actually 30% of the households with incomes at or beneath the 80%. Also, we received, part of his recommendation included testimony from one of the workers of SEIU 32 BJ, who are requesting high quality service jobs within, and they are in support of this project. Also, we received correspondence from Council Member Palma, who is supporting this project. Let me just take one more look, see if I didn't leave anything out. I believe I covered everything. I am available for questions.
Questions from the commission. Vice Chair Knuckles.
Manny, with regard to the parking spaces, are some of them allocated to the church?
Yes, some will be allocated to the church, yes. Yes.
There are 56
spaces, yes.
Do you know how many?
No, I can get that information for you, plus the applicant will be here Wednesday with his team to testify.
Okay.
Thank you. I share concern about the size of the units, not in and of themselves, since I don't think I'm giving anything away by saying I actually think it's a good idea to have smaller units. But with that comes an obligation to have additional public, additional common space. And the 1,500 square feet for a community room seems very skimpy when you have these size units. Has there been any discussion about
No.
The size of common space?
No. To my knowledge, no. However, again, they'll be here on Wednesday to testify.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Manny, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Question. Not having plans, you really can't tell whether any of the units face on to the parking area. And the reason for my question is because it seems to be a missed opportunity where, you know, a platform could be built on at the second level, providing green space for the tenants, not having to look at cars. It's just a missed opportunity here. So if we can find out if there's any windows, any residences that face onto the parking area, that would be great.
I will.
There's access. So,
other questions from the commission? Commissioner
Levin. Yes, ma'am. Do we know what the size of the congregation is of the church? Or, I mean, how many people are likely to show up for services?
I don't know. I can find that out for you.
I think understanding that and matching it with the parking information would be helpful.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Manny, on Wednesday, if they could just speak to the status of the financing. I'm assuming it's HPD. I'm assuming it's any number of programs in order to get to this depth of affordability.
Okay.
So that would be helpful.
Right.
Other questions? Okay, this item will go to public hearing on April 5th.
Okay, thank you.
On page 352 of your agenda, the Unionport Bridge replacement is coming back from the Community Board and Borough President for modification of the legal grades to facilitate the reconstruction of the Unionport Bridge over Westchester Creek. Philip Montgomery, the Chief Engineer of Technical Review, is here to present the application.
Thank you.
Chief Engineer.
Good afternoon. Today, returning for pre-hearing review, I have an application by the New York City Department of Transportation, Division of Bridges, Movable Bridge Group, seeking an amendment to the city map. The proposed amendment involves the modification of legal grades on Bruckner Boulevard between Zuriga Avenue and Rush Avenue in the Unionport, Schuylerville, and Bronx Neck neighborhoods of the Bronx Community Districts 9 and 10. The proposed city map amendment would facilitate the replacement of the Unionport Bridge over Westchester Creek. The existing Unionport Bridge is located below the Cross Bronx Expressway, Bruckner Expressway interchange structures just to the west of their intersection with the Hutchinson River Parkway. The bridge supplies an important connection between the elevated roadways and as well as the surface roadways here and here. Area land uses include a mix of commercial and industrial along Westchester Creek and low density residential as you travel further east and west from the project south. Nearby notable locations include the former Whitestone Cinema site here, Home Depot here, Monsignor Scanlon High School here, Broad's Neck Shopping Center here, and the St. Raymond Cemetery here. The Unionport Bridge is part of multiple MTA bus routes, including VX5 and Q44 buses. The first Unionport Bridge was built in this location in 1872. It was replaced in 1918 and again in 1953 with major repairs in 1971. It is a double-leaf bascule design that receives over 60,000 vehicles per day and is suffering from structural and operational deficiencies, including lane widths, pedestrian facilities, and the geometry of the roadway approach routes. As of 2012, the bridge had a New York State DOT bridge rating of 3.5 out of 7. New York State DOT defines a deficient bridge as one with a state condition rating less than 5. The proposed bridge will consist of two parallel single-leaf bascule spans. It will feature three 12-foot lanes in each direction, a 12-foot shared bikeway pedestrian lane on the north, and an 8-foot wide pedestrian space on the south. The sidewalks and bikeway will connect the bridge to surface roads, Zuriga Avenue and Brush Avenue. The upgraded pedestrian facilities will provide safe access to and from the residential, commercial, and community facility spaces located on either side of Westchester Creek. While the grade of the new bridge is very similar to that of the existing bridge, the elimination of non-standard approach geometry and the widening of the bridge results in changes to legal grades. Grade changes are typically several inches, but are maximum of 1.5 feet, with the greater changes being concentrated along the approach ramps. Construction of the new bridge will be completed in stages and include two temporary bridges allowing two lanes of traffic in both directions and a 5-foot wide pedestrian bridge over Westchester Creek to remain open at all times. The staged construction will consist of constructing the south leaf in the open position while the existing bridge remains operational. The construction of the two temporary bridges, the removal of the existing bridge, completion of the first span, removal of the temporary bridges, construction on the north span, and then once it's completed, you have a completed bridge open to traffic. Community Board 9 voted 25 in favor, 0 against, and 0 abstaining to approve. Community Board 10 voted 28 in favor, 0 against, with 1 abstaining to approve. And the borough president approved the application with the following modifications. All measures should be implemented to expedite the construction and minimize noise, debris, dust, and other negative impact on local traffic and surrounding communities. The staging area during construction should be cleaned and landscaped after completion. The Department of Parks and Recreation should participate in the design, implementation, and maintenance of the pedestrian bicycle shared lanes at the intersection of Grant B and Zariga Avenue. All street lighting incorporated into the bridge design should be extended to Zariga Avenue and Brush Avenue. The appropriate city agencies should work with businesses to minimize the impact of vessel traffic during the 60-day, 21-foot height restriction period. And lastly, the borough president urged the city to explore an additional northbound traffic light to be located at the stop line along Brush Avenue to prevent intersection encroachment.
Thank you. Questions from the commission? Commissioner Ortiz.
Quick question. On the north side, you show a bike lane. Is that connected to a network of lanes?
I'm not sure. I don't know if the bike lanes where it connects to Zariga Avenue, if there's another network going from there.
Okay. I mean, it would be helpful to know or hopefully
yes.
ensure that that happens.
Yes. Right.
Commissioner Cantor.
How would you know that? Question, please.
I think I've been there, too.
I know.
That bridge is nasty.
as you can see, looking around the city, you could throw up a 50-story apartment house in 2.5 years maximum. What is the main cause, in your judgment, of the long runtime between the day of a facility is closed, such as this, and it's completed? Why is it years as opposed to a couple of years?
My opinion of that is the fact that the bridge has to be constructed while traffic is being maintained, and that leads to the multiple stages that increase the time. But the applicant team can be here on Wednesday to further address that.
I'd be curious, what it would cost the city in money to speed up the process? I expected the answer, but I've gone through this with several transportation commissioners, and I always get the same answer. It almost, to me, cries for a task force on seeing how to slow down the slowness of construction. Thank you.
Other questions? Then this item will go to a public hearing on April 5th.
Thank you. We're going to move on to discuss the future votes. Coming up on April 5th, staff has prepared a favorable report for 600 East 156th Street in the Bronx. It's a 12-story mixed-use building with 170 residential units and community facility and retail space. A community board and borough president both approved, and the applicant sent to you renderings of the rear of the building for your request that was in your package last week.
Electronically.
Electronically, yes.
Sorry.
Okay. Westchester Muse is zoning text and zoning map change to facilitate the construction of 203 dwelling units of affordable housing. The community board and the borough president also both approved. 1860 Eastern Parkway, zoning text and map amendments to facilitate construction of a residential building with 67 dwelling units, all affordable. Community board and borough president also both approved. 95 Evergreen Avenue is the acquisition of office space for the consolidation of HRA offices in Brooklyn. Community board and borough president approved. I'm sorry. We got a letter of approval from the borough president, none from the community board. 19 East 70th Street, a special permit to convert a office building in Manhattan back into a single family residence. Community board and borough president approved. 640 Broadway, to modify the height and setback regulations to allow penthouses on the roof of an existing six-story building. The applicant modified the application to restore a recreational space on the roof of the building. And the borough president and committee board both approved that modification. On April 26th, staff is proposing to prepare reports in favor of three applications on Canal Street that would allow ground floor retail space in three contiguous buildings at 359, 361, and 357 Canal Street. Community board disapproved the application, but the borough president approved. We have a landmark designation for the Cathedral of St. John the Divine in Morningside. We have the Morningside Heights Historic District, which you had a presentation on earlier today. And we also have an application to landmark the interiors of the Waldorf Astoria Hotel. The exterior of the hotel is already a landmark. Mm-hmm. In all those cases, staff has found that there is no...
I just have one question about the interior of the Waldorf. There's construction going on right now. Is time of the essence? How does this work?
Hurry up.
I am not clear on the nature of the construction, but
it's pretty substantial.
It's closed. It's closed for construction.
I will find out from Landmarks what's going on there, and this we will discuss that at our next review session when this will be coming back for public hearing on that Wednesday. Sure.
Can I ask a question about the Cathedral St. John the Divine?
Sure.
That landmark action, it looks as if there are an enormous number of unused development rights associated with the cathedral. Mm-hmm. The world's most giant building, and it's like one FAR. So it looks, I'd like just confirmation that there are no known development sites. We got a table that showed a number of sites to which development rights could be transferred. It looks like there are four of them mm-hmm. that could be considered soft sites. It looks to me like none of them are really potential development sites because two of them are owned by the city. One was built as a residential building built in 1991, and one is a co-op. But I think we need to understand the real landing possibilities of those development rights and whether this landmarking is likely to change the, have some of these development rights get used in the short term.
We will explore that further and bring that back to you.
Okay, thank you.
I am sure.
Sure.
Perhaps just an FYI. The American Planning Association National Conference is going to be here in New York May 6th and 7th, I believe. They encourage planning commissioners to attend. There is a discount for planning commissioners who are recognized as such, and I believe James is going to fill out a simple form to allow those of you who are interested to utilize that designation, and I encourage you to do so.
And I'm just putting in a plug because at least two of our fellow commissioners will be speaking. Anyone want to identify themselves?
I'm giving a tour.
And we're very pleased that there will be a tour of Hudson Yards, which is generating a lot of interest among APA members.
Thank you.
Can I just ask, are we going to have a discussion at a different time about 251 Front Street, or is that...
We,
withdrawn or something?
No.
Just checking.
It has not been withdrawn. We are awaiting for some information from the applicant, so we pushed the vote back a little bit. Okay. So, because we have a lot of time on that still.
Okay.
So we will be bringing it back at our next review session.
Okay, great.
We haven't forgotten
about it.
Okay.
A lot of skeptics. Okay, we're up to 125 Edgewater Street in Staten Island. The Staten Island office sent you a memo, which was in your package this weekend.
Electronic.
Was it electronic?
No. Yeah.
Okay.
Commissioner Sorlo.
Okay. Yeah, so just a question, since obviously I'm sure this is helpful in some way, but you'd need to speak the language of the memo. So what I'm going to ask, you know, when we get to things like Richmond datum and the base plane and the, just if we can just create a reality on what this means. And I guess my question would be two-pronged. One is, since the issue that arose that generates this sort of modification and the memo grew out of a request made by the applicant, or so it seems, does it address what the applicant was asking? I'm assuming it does, but what does it mean in relationship to what the applicant has asked? And two, what does it mean in terms of the development and the community? And given the community board's issue about height, which again, I'm not focusing on that, but I just don't know how to take this information and relate it to what we already know, since we won't have any other opportunity to do this.
Sure. The practical effect of what's the change proposed in the memo is that there would be no change to the development as presented to you.
Okay.
What it's really doing is taking an error that we found in the text, essentially, and just making a clarification for how we're applying height rules to account for the existing floodplain. So the location of the text where it was written previously just was in a very specific section of the special district rules. So it could be interpreted that it was applicable only to very specific calculations. And so the issue that was identified by the applicants was that, for example, when they were looking to apply commercial signage on the facade of the commercial uses, which of course are on the second floor, because of where it was in the old text, they wouldn't be able to do that. The signage would have to be sort of below the ground floor, ceiling, and below. So with this change, they can now put the commercial signage on the commercial uses on the second floor. So that was really the impetus behind the change.
Okay.
But the development as was presented to you is
it's the same.
Saw. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All
sorry
right.
For the angst. Commissioner Besser.
Thank you so much. So that's the only change.
That is the only change.
Thank you.
And 1315 Greenpoint Avenue, a text amendment to reorient the massing of a building to front on Transmitter Park. Jonah is here if you have any questions on this application.
Commissioner Levin. Are we going to get follow-up information from them about the use of air rights?
Yes.
And the scale of the building with or without?
Mm-hmm. So I didn't include it in the package, but I can speak to it right now.
Yeah.
So they've confirmed that they're proposing 4,000 square feet of air rights transfers, and that's proposed. It hasn't been entered into an agreement yet, and it's roughly equivalent to one story of a building, or even less. So that's, and that was actually studied as part of the environmental review.
And that's what the drawing
showed. Yes.
The renderings, the renderings we showed include the proposed transfer. It's
okay. And if they don't work out that deal, well, I guess they've got sort of four or five buildings along the street that they could try and work. Do they still build without those air rights?
Yes.
And just build smaller?
Yeah.
The project is feasible if they don't get those air rights.
That's right. Yeah. It's a relatively small amount. It's a few thousand square feet. One other quick clarification is that one speaker noted that there's a historic district along Greenpoint Avenue. There is a historic district further a few blocks away, and there's a pencil factory. It's a landmark, but the Greenpoint Avenue is not part of a historic district, and actually the applicants made an effort to kind of step down towards Greenpoint Avenue to respond to that. And then lastly, I just really quickly want to mentioned that they did do a full shadows analysis as part of the seeker review. And so they looked at four different times of the year and analyzed how the as of right and proposed would affect the shadows on the park.
Questions from the commission? If not, the review session is over. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I just want to remind that we're doing field tours out to Rockaway on April 5th and May 8th. April 5th, we're meeting here and going out together to the Rockaways. On May 8th, the meeting in the field.
Okay.